am so weak, nothing I do will last. But with power from you, Lord, everything that I do will be here when time has passed. Lord, give me a crucified heart, broken in two and made exactly like you. Lord, may I be willing to die, daily take up my cross with a crucified heart. You are the key to what I can be. I have you in my heart. So cleanse every part, making me a new start. With you I am crucified. Lord, give me a crucified heart, broken in two and made exactly like you. Lord, may I be willing to die, daily take up my cross with a crucified heart. Lord, give me a crucified heart, broken in two and made exactly like you. Lord, may I be willing to die, daily take up my cross with a crucified heart. Daily take up my cross with a crucified heart.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. Take the Word of God with me, if you would, and go to the first book of the Bible, Genesis. Genesis chapter 1, we'll begin in just a minute. We looked at last week, as we think about love one to another, we talked about love in the home, and we're going to continue with that theme today. And thinking of love in the home, you say, well, I'm not married. Well, that doesn't mean it doesn't apply to you. It certainly does. And Lord willing, God might bring that day of marriage, or if nothing else, you're going to teach someone what God's Word says, kids, grandkids, and on, about helping them in the home. And so there's certainly some help there for all of us, and the Word of God is profitable. No doubt about that. Next Sunday, we'll shift gears, begin looking at missions and thinking, get our mind thinking about what God has the mission of the church is missions. And so we'll begin thinking and praying that way and looking forward to that. But today we'll be focusing on this. You know, there's been a lot of sickness going around and people, I know, taking care of one another with these colds and flu and stuff like that. I read something this week, talk about marriage, you know, how it is in the beginning and how things sometimes change a little bit. And some of you might resemble some of this. It's called the 7 years of the married cold. First year marriage, sugar dumpling, I'm really worried about my baby girl. You've got a bad sniffle, and there's no telling about these things. With all the strep going around, I'm putting you in the hospital this afternoon and for a general checkup and a good rest. I know the food's lousy, but I'll be bringing you food from Olive's Garden. I already have it all arranged with the floor superintendent there at the hospital. The second year of marriage, listen, darling, I don't like the sound of that cough. I've called Doc Miller to rush over here. Now you go to bed, be a good girl. Third year, maybe better lie down, honey. Nothing like a little rest when you feel lousy. I'll bring you some soup. Fourth year, now look, dear, be sensible. After you fed the kids and done the dishes and washed the floor, you'd better lie down. Fifth year, why don't you take a couple aspirin? Sixth year, I wish you'd just gargle or something instead of sitting around barking like a seal all evening. Seventh year, for Pete's sake, stop sneezing. You trying to give me pneumonia? Oh, sometimes it gets that way, doesn't it? And I thought that was funny. You know, you think about marriage after growing up in a preacher's home and being around ministry all my life and 13 years now in the ministry, you find that many times couples put way more thought into the marriage ceremony than they put into their married life. And all the planning, all the work, all the thinking, dreaming, and there's nothing wrong with that. I'm not saying there is. It goes into thought of the wedding and how special, and it is special, it's wonderful. But many times, they've never put thought in how their marriage is going to be and lived out beyond the wedding day. And God's word, of course, speaks to that, and that's where real life is. The wedding's wonderful, but that's not real life. That's just a beginning. That's a starting point, and then there's life to be lived, and years of that, as many of you could speak about how many years you've been married. Brother Watkins, you were telling me, wasn't it, Brother Tommy, that 70 years it's going to be in June? Is that right? I think so. He was telling me 70 years. Isn't that amazing? 70 years they've been married, and it's a little different than the wedding day. You got to put some thought in to be married 70 years, don't you? And so this is something that we have to remind ourselves. In fact, I have to remind it of, and all of us have to remind it of often, that the Christian life is not lived somewhere out there or even in here. The Christian life begins and is lived in the home. Yes, we ought to live it everywhere we go, but that's your real Christian life, what you are at home. And your children, your spouse, they ought to know and be able to speak the sweetest tones about your Christian walk because they know the real deal. They know the real thing. We might see today and you look great, and you see me and you think, well, you know, you look okay, you know, but you know, you might say you look like you're, you know, on point with the Lord, but what happens in the home is really where we're at, isn't it? And so that's we have to be reminded of that. Of this is where the Lord begins, always at the heart of the matter. And that Christian home must be built on a marriage that continues to follow God's principles. The most wonderful work we do on earth is the work we do in establishing a Christian home. A Christian home. I'll tell you, there's people in this room that we're trying to have influence in their life. Me personally, I'm spending time with during the week and meeting with different ones and trying to have an influence, discipling, mentoring. But there'll be no one in all of my ministry that I have more influence on than I have on my spouse and on my children. And the same's for you. See, the greatest thing we have is influence. Our testimony, influence. The Word of God, certainly the power of God and Christ. But as far as what we have to use that gives weight to what we say we believe is our influence. And the influence we're going to have is the strongest in our home. And the influence and opportunity that we have with people is in our home. And so this is so important that everything grows out of that. And it ought to be beautiful as it grows out of that central place, that place where we live, our home. That Christian home is built on a marriage that continues to follow God's principles. It needs to be founded on the Word of God. Yeah, we have to get back to the Bible, where this is where we found our marriage on. This is what we are studying to think, God, what do you say about marriage? What do you say about home life? What should the Christian home look like? And then developing a oneness in marriage, a oneness in Christ in marriage. And this oneness, by the way, is what will serve as the fertile ground for all else that the Lord desires to do in and through us. Somewhere, sometime in recent history in America, I don't know that we could say exactly where, but a line's been crossed. I don't know that we could say the exact date it happened, but it's definitely been crossed. And the line is the line between what a Christian home and Christian marriage once looked like versus a non-Christian home or non-Christian marriage. And somewhere that line has been crossed. You say, what are you speaking about? Well, married couples in America spend an average of 27 and a half minutes per week talking to each other. According to Ray Bridgewistell, speech communication expert. However, they spend 46 hours per week watching TV. There'll be 2.5 million divorces in America this year. 2.5 million. There'll be 6 million children born in America this year. And when we crossed that invisible line, wherever that was in our nation, what happened, one of the things that happened is fatherhood began to cease. It began to diminish in our nation, began disappearing. And marriage became under attack. Think of this statistic. In the U.S., 1 out of every 3 women that conceive will have an abortion. 1 out of every 3. Of the children that are conceived in America will have an abortion. Out of the 2 that are conceived, that are actually born, out of the 2, 1/3, 1 out of every 3 of those, or the other, there's 3 of them, 1 is aborted, 1 of them will be born in a home where there is no father present. And then the third, so only one out of every three children that are conceived in America are born into a home where there's both a father and mother present. That's the condition of the homes in our nation. Now, that's not speaking just about Christian homes. That's talking about all homes. But think of what that says about our nation, which so long we've held to be Christian and founded on Christian principles. What the devil is doing in the destruction of the building block of society, the home, and marriage. And so there's no doubt marriage is under attack. The home is under attack. And today we must define again, from the clear instruction of the Word of God, what God intends for the home and His original design in marriage. So Genesis, you found your place there. Let's begin looking at chapter 1 and verse 26. And God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth." So God created man in His own image. In the image of God created He him, male and female, created He them. Stop there just a moment. You think of God saying, we're going to create Him in our image. The Bible says that God is a spirit, and they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. He's a spirit. So when He says that He's created us in His image, He's talking about spirit, soul, and body. That's the image that we, not this physical image, a nose and ears and eyes. We know God took on flesh, became a man, but that's not what He's speaking of here. He says that in chapter 2, we'll see it. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, "Be fruitful, and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth." Chapter 2, verse 7. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Different than every other creation, we were made in the image of God, spirit, soul, and body. He breathed into us the breath of life. Let's skip down to verse 18, if you would. And the Lord God said, "It is not good that the man should be alone. I'll make him a helpmeet for him." And out of the ground, the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air and brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them. And whatsoever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof. Adam gave names to all cattle, the fowl of the air, and every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was not found an helpmeet for him. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept. And he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. And the rib, which the Lord God had taken from man, made he a woman and brought her unto the man. And Adam said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh." I want to focus in on that principle, that theme. You find it throughout scriptures. What we see in verse 24, and we'll bring the message entitled, "When Two Become One." When two become one. And let's pray together. Father, we need you now. Help us as we look in your word. May your spirit have free rule and reign in me and in everyone here today. May we give you that license right now that you, Lord, can make any change. Lord, may you have free reign as we live in the attitude of yes to Jesus Christ, that, Lord, whatever needs to be changed, whatever needs to be stopped or started in our life, may we say yes to you as you speak to us individually. As you're the real preacher, as we look at your word, speak to us now, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We find this principle in verse 24 throughout the scriptures. Jesus reiterates this and puts an exclamation point and even expands of what you see in verse 24. "Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave in his wife, and they shall be one flesh." You can turn there if you like, but let me read to you Matthew chapter 19, verse 4. And following it says, "And he answered," Jesus did, "and said unto them, Have ye not read that he which made them at the beginning made them male and female, and said, For this cause shall a man leave father and mother, and shall cleave to his wife, and they twain shall be one flesh. Wherefore they are no more twain, but one flesh. What therefore God had joined together, let not man put asunder. They say unto him, Why did Moses then command to give a right in divorcement, to put her away? He saith unto them, Moses, because of the hardness of your heart, suffered you to put away your wives, but from the beginning it was not so." And so when two become one, Jesus emphasized what we even say this at the wedding altar, don't we? What God had joined together, let no man put asunder. The Lord Jesus in Mark chapter 10, verse 7, through 9 says, "For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, and they twain shall be one flesh. So then they are no more twain, but one flesh. Whatever God had joined together, let not man put asunder." So he emphasized, Jesus underscored, he reiterated this principle put together in the Word of God put here in Genesis right in the beginning. We talked about that last week. There was no father, mother. Here Adam and Eve are saying, and Adam is giving, there's a principle, verse 24, given in Genesis 2. They don't have any father, mother. What's he talking about? This is going to be the principle carried throughout the Word of God for marriage, that they would leave father and mother and cleave to their wife, husband to wife, wife to husband. And that was God's plan. They would become one flesh, joined together by the Lord. When I think of this theme, this thought of oneness in marriage, when two become one, oneness in marriage. Here's a heavenly pattern. This is a Bible blueprint given on what God intends for marriage, a divine design for your home. And for mine, this is what the Lord's given. And this is what we need. This is what we need in our marriages. This is what we need in our homes. A lot of the results that we're dealing with in a nation of rebellious children and teenagers and college students that are what we would think is bizarre behavior comes from the home where mom and dad are not one, where father and mother are not together. There's not a unity in Christ that the Lord intended to be in the home. They're divided. They're separate. There's more and more kids growing up not seeing what a home ought to look like. They have no idea of what it ought to be. And by the way, as we think of that, it's not just about your happiness and mine. I want you to have a happy home. I want you to have a little piece of heaven on earth in your home. But it's not just about that or your children anymore. I'm telling you, how long until America doesn't have a pattern of a home to look at, to point at? I remember hearing guys that grew up in, that were in Bible college with me, that grew up in a broken home, and they talked about there was a family on a bus route that come by and picked them up. There was a family in the church that took them under their wing, would have them over, and they didn't have a father in the home, but this man in this church, this godly man, would do things with them and treat them like his, you know, son, and he got to see what a Christian home was to look like because of that godly man and woman in that church that took him under the wing, because he didn't see it in his home. But how long in America, if homes and marriages and that are even in the church continue to decline until there's no example, no pattern that someone can point at and say, "I want my marriage to be like that. This is what God intended. This is what the Lord said we should have in marriage." If we're not careful, it could be very soon. We have children here today. There are children that when Mary drove a school bus that would talk about their home life and things that you and I maybe have never seen that happened over the weekend and who mom had over and how many, amen, and all this type of nonsense and the things that's happening in a home life that should never be. And no wonder they grow up and their marriage or their home is like it is, because they don't know what a home and marriage ought to be. They've never seen it. So how important it is that you and I, as God's children, develop a home and a marriage that is Christian truly, and develop a home and marriage that people could look at and say, this is what God intended when he put husband and wife together in a Christian home is ought to look like, with father, mother, and children like that. And so it's needed. It's needed for your home and happiness. It's needed for your children and grandchildren to see, but it's needed for our nation to see a pattern that's lived out, the Lord's pattern for a Christian home. We have to get the gospel and God's word to people, I'm telling you. For marriage and family, they need it. People need the gospel. They cannot have a Christian home without it. I want to tell you, you may be here, and I hope the message helps you. There's some principle that you can help in your home. But if you don't know the Lord Jesus as your Savior, you'll never have a Christian home without the Lord Jesus. You're a teenager. You're children, boys and girls, teenagers in here, you can't be the boy and girl and teenager and that you ought to be without knowing Christ as Savior. You can't be obedient as God's commanded you to be without the Lord Jesus helping you to live and obey His Word. And so that is the great need. I want to just invite you right from the beginning. If you don't know our Savior, we've sung about it, His life for mine. He gave Himself for you. He paid on the cross of Calvary and bled and died for you. And we're all sinners. And Jesus said that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. He said the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And I want you to know, he wants you to be saved today. That's why you're here. No question about it. He can help your home like nothing else can. That's where it begins. And I'm going to invite you at the end to be saved and come to know him as your personal Savior if you don't know him. But for us that know Christ, we have a home and a responsibility to have a Christian home like he says. And this is what we find in the Word of God as a pattern. I want to tell you, I owe a lot to my parents. My parents were not perfect. They're not perfect, just like I'm not. But they showed me Christ. They have lots of things, and I can stand up and tell lots of things that weren't right in the home. But I could also tell you lots of things that were. They're just like you and me. They weren't perfect parents. They didn't have a perfect marriage. But the Lord Jesus Christ was the center. And from that, everything else grew out of. And I owe a lot to them. I got to see in a home what it ought to be. And there are people, some in this room, some of you, that could say, I didn't see that in the home I grew up in. But may God help us to have a home like that now. That would be a Christian home. Like God intends. All of us know that marriage is under attack. Any union in marriage that is not one man and one woman is a plan for the demise and destruction of marriage. And the devil is at work to do that. He's tearing down the cornerstone. This is the cornerstone of civilization, home, marriage. And so he wants to break that down. Who's to say that marriage cannot be two men and one woman, or three men, or three women and one man? See, once you violate the principle of the Word of God, once we enact laws that violate this clear teaching of God's Word, it will result in the destruction and the demise of marriage and the home, which is the cornerstone of civilization that God's established for mankind. Look, marriage between one man and one woman is not only God's design and God's command, but it's the building block on which all else in life comes from. That home and the family stands on that. I read Psalm 11 yesterday as I was reading the Psalms, and Psalm 11, 3 says, if the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? If the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? And I like the answer in the next verse. The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. His eyes behold, his eyelids try the children of men. We have to run to the Lord. We have to run to his word. We have to have a revolution back to the Bible, that God's word would be where we pattern our life and our marriage and our home out of. I want to have a wonderful marriage, don't you? I want to have a wonderful home where it'd be a place of heaven on earth. And I believe there are certain elements in every marriage that would make it that way, to make a wonderful marriage possible. The first one I want to give you is a marriage of spiritual foundation. A marriage of spiritual foundation. It must be built on the spiritual. I'd like to say this. The most wonderful way to enjoy God's gift of the physical union in marriage is to not begin with it. I said the most wonderful way to enjoy God's gift of the physical union in marriage is not to begin with it. What I mean by that is, in our nation and around the world, that is the thing that is number one. How that boy or girl looks, and how attractive she is, and how, and I'm trying to choose choice words, but you know the words that they use. And everything's about that. And everything's about the physical. They begin their relationship with the kissing and the hugging, the touching. It's all about that. And that's how it begins. The best way to have that wonderful gift that God gave to marriage is to not begin with it. It must be built on spiritual foundation. That's where the beginning needs to be. That the spiritual foundation, then from that everything can grow, becoming one in spirit, one in soul, and one in body. Oneness in marriage. Lots can be said about that. We'll say more this evening. But that's where the world begins. And that's where they emphasize is, this is the only important thing. And then they find out when they get married that life is daily. As one person said, the only problem with life is it's so daily. Yeah. It's not an event, it's a life. And so there's much more than just the physical in it. The spiritual foundation, a marriage of spiritual foundation, that's an element that is necessary to make a wonderful marriage possible. Then a marriage of lifetime commitment. A marriage of lifetime commitment. That's what Jesus said didn't he? We just read it, Matthew 19, 6 through 8 there. So he was talking about, he said, from the beginning, it was not so. Well, Moses said we're going to do it, but from the beginning, that wasn't the plan. Lifetime commitment, determined from the beginning in our hearts that it's a lifetime covenant that we're making. This is not something we're going to try and see how it works out. This is a lifetime covenant that is being made from the very beginning. Not only does this help the moment we enter into marriage, but it helps with so many little frivolous things that come up in marriage, that the word divorce is never used. The thought of I'm going to leave you is never entered in because we've made a covenant and commitment that I'm going till death to us part, like we committed to God, we're going to stay together. And so there's a commitment like that. And it's easier to get over those frivolous things then if that's the commitment you've made in marriage. You ever fight about something silly? I mean, stupid and silly, right? I mean, just nuts. I remember a story that had been passed down, I think. Maybe it had gotten embellished over the years, but of my grandma and my grandpa on my mom's side. I didn't know them as well. My grandma died of stomach cancer when I was a teenager. But my mom tells a story. They had five kids. Like, it was in my family, five kids. My mom was the oldest of five. And they went to Dairy Queen one day. And here they went through Dairy Queen, and Grandpa turned to Grandma and said, "What do you want?" And she said she wanted a pineapple sundae. So he ordered a pineapple sundae, you know. They get through the drive-thru and hand in everybody's thing or whatever. She says, "Well, what in the world did you order me pineapple sundae for?" He said, "Well, that's what you wanted. That's what you said you wanted." "I don't like pineapple. You know I don't like pineapple. Why would you order me this?" "That's what you said. Kids, five kids, you know. But didn't that what Mom said? She wanted pineapple sundae." And that's what you said, Mom, you know, and "I didn't order this." And they got into a fight, a big fight. Finally, she opened the window and threw it out, you know, and the kids are like, you know, you in a big family, "Oh, I'd eat that," you know, but just a big fight over something silly. Now, why she said pineapple, she was thinking something else and read it, I don't know. But you ever been there, you fight over something just silly, you know, and maybe you could have a sillier story than that, you know, just dumb things. A marriage of lifetime commitment. There are people that if you ask them why they're divorced today, the reason, if they got back to where it started, so often is something so silly. And then pride enters in. There's people that aren't in churches today because something's so silly, and then pride enters in. Yeah. I read this about a man who had gone through a marriage breakup. He wrote to a nationally known columnist as a warning to other readers. He said this, 11 years ago, I walked out on a 12-year marriage. My wife was a good person, but for a long time, she was going through a lot of stress. Instead of helping her, I began an affair with her best friend. It was a disaster. This is what I gave up, seeing my daughter grow up. The respect of many longtime friends. The enjoyment of living as a family. And a wife who was loyal, was appreciative, and tried very hard to make me happy. This is what I got. Two stepchildren who treated me like dirt. A wife who didn't know how to make anything for dinner but reservations. A wife whose only interest in me was how much money she could get. And a wife who made disparaging remarks about my family and ruined all my existing friendships. Finally, the best thing I got was a bitter, expensive divorce with her too. Tell your readers that anyone who's married and has his or her next mate all lined up is looking for trouble. People don't know what they're giving up until they no longer have it. Then it's too late. Think of how Christmas would be, or Thanksgiving, or things like that after a breakup, a divorce. Marriage of lifetime commitment. This is one of those elements that makes wonderful marriage possible. Then a marriage of mutual submission. A marriage of mutual submission. We all know, and maybe husbands really know that verse, you know, the Bible says about in a family, how a man's to lead his family and the wife is to be in submission, subjecting to her own husband. But in that same passage, Ephesians 5, let me read it to you. Ephesians 5:22 says, "Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord." We know that verse. But back up one verse, Ephesians 5:21 says, "Submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God." And so there's mutual submission in marriage. Love one to another. The man is to love his wife as Christ loved the church. Think of that. Wow, talk about something to live up to, men. We're to love our wife as Christ loved the church. You see, not only is the wife submissive to the husband, but he's submissive to her. and sensitive to her needs. And he loves her as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. And he makes the commitment to her that Christ made to the church. Aren't you glad for this promise? We all know it. Hebrews 13:5, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. And the husband is to make that same commitment. And it's not just obviously in divorce or in a physical way, but in our thought life. Never leaving the wife. We're to never leave or forsake her. Then a marriage of intimacy, the next essential, this element that makes a marriage possible. A marriage of intimacy. This doesn't just encompass physical intimacy. I want to read you just a portion of what Pastor Sexton said in his book, Marriage Math. He writes this, if you have been married long enough and you have been through the dark valleys together, you know there are times of intimacy in marriage that are not moments of physical intimacy. There are times of love and tenderness, times of understanding, times of patience, times of tender words spoken and gentle touches, times of sympathetic communication and prayer. Sometimes no words are spoken at all, just listening. But you're not going to have a wonderful marriage unless there's intimacy in that marriage. You know, surprise kisses are one of the enjoyments, wonderful things in marriage, you know. And to give and to get. Amen. And I enjoyed one of those this week. You know, that I'll tell you, that's a blessing. Intimacy in marriage. This is one of the essentials. And it's not just talking about the physical. A marriage then that is growing. A marriage that is growing. Success in marriage does not come from finding the right person. Hear me out. Success in marriage does not come from finding the right person, but rather from your commitment to become the right person. See, quit looking for some magic formula for a happy marriage. You become the husband and wife that God commands you to be. Become that husband. Become that wife that God says you to be. And your spouse deserves to have. Think about your spouse's parents. I'm thinking about three daughters that I pray for. My own, pray for their husbands one day. Think about your spouse and a father, grandparent, or mother that prayed over them and the spouse that they would one day have, that they would love them and treat them correctly and all that type of thing, that they would be the type of husband or the type of wife that they are to be. And think about the Heavenly Father's thoughts towards us, how He desires for you to have the spouse that He talked about in His Word that would be a wonderful oneness together in marriage. And we have a responsibility to be the right person. See? Men, quit looking for the perfect girl. You're already married to her. You know? God's choice for you. That's the perfect choice. God's choice for you. Quit looking. You become the man that you should be. Ladies, quit looking for the perfect man. You become the lady that God says you should be. Pray, encourage your husband to become that perfect man, that one that God's chosen for you. I say again, success in marriage does not come from finding the right person, but rather from your commitment to become that right person. You become that person. Growing, see. Essential is a marriage that is growing. When I talk to someone in mentoring, not talking about necessarily in a marriage context, but I can't help people that aren't in the room. But the person that I'm trying to encourage and help is the one I'm talking to, the one I'm sitting in front of. And you can't control what someone else does. You can't change what they're going to do. Now, hopefully they'll react to your spirit of Christ, but regardless, you have to commit. And that person I'm trying to help, whatever the circumstance around it, all I'm trying to do is help them to do right and be what Christ would have them be in the situation. Because you can't control what the other person's going to do. You can't make them do. But you can choose that I'm going to be regardless of what they do. And that's what God would intend for us. The Lord doesn't say, husbands, you make your wife do this and that. Wives, you make your husband. No matter what, you treat them until they do this or that. He doesn't say that. He says, husbands, listen, this is how you need to be, husbands. And he says, wives, this is how you need to be. And there's no, you know, statement under the bottom there saying, but if he doesn't do right, you don't have to do right. You know, it doesn't say that. Or if she doesn't do what she should do, then you don't have, it doesn't say that. It says you do this, and this is your responsibility to God, regardless of what they do. See?
And Lord, help us. The Bible says we're to grow in grace, the knowledge of the Lord. It's either growing or dying. That's the truth about anything. As your body is that way. We were growing until they say around age 25, and ever since then we've been dying. You know, that's the same thing in your marriage. It's either growing and becoming more wonderful, or it's dying. And slowly, you may not see it today, you may not see it the first day, but over time, it'll become dying more and more. The Bible says we're to grow. God sometimes has to break us to help us grow. Sometimes our heart has to be hurt and broken, and we're broken. That allows God to stretch the capacity we have to love. Think how much growing you've done during times of hurting. I'm not talking about in your marriage, and this is the problem, but just you hurt together because something in your home or something in your family or something in your work or just a hurt. Think of the growing and how much growing we've done during painful times. Think of how much growing we've done dealing with things that we thought were the most difficult thing we've ever dealt with in life. See, God is stretching us. And as we were bearing this circumstance in the Spirit of Jesus Christ, He was building us. He was growing us. He was increasing and stretching the capacity we had to love. And as we were saying, somehow, some way, God will help us through this. God's going to help us. And through it all, we learned to count on the Lord in a more meaningful way. And through it all, we learned to count on one another in a more meaningful way. And God grows us like this as life goes on, doesn't it? In the home, in the marriage. Well, in conclusion, I want you to think of this. Mary and I remember we were 20 and 22 when we got married. By the way, I've come to believe and understand that if you have a wonderful marriage, it's a marriage that continues to grow and develop. If you have a wonderful marriage, it's a marriage that continues to grow and develop. Because life changes. Things change, don't they? Mary and I were 20 and 22 when we got married. Just kids, you know. We just graduated from college. And we were in just a 3 months' time. We were in Kentucky. And I was assistant pastor at the first church there. Assistant principal in their school. And Mary was teaching in high school and 7th and 8th grade. And there we were. We started out and serving the Lord. And it was wonderful. We were excited. LaRue Baptist Church there in Kentucky. And we had a lot of growing to do, and in our marriage, a lot of growing to do in our marriage. We just married, and we made mistakes. Let me rephrase, correction, I made mistakes, you know, and big mistakes sometimes, yeah. But God helped us work through things, and we grew, and we worked through other things, and we grew. Then 2 years into our marriage and into our ministry, the pastor, after a Sunday evening service, he's getting his van to leave. And we lived on the property. The church was in the front of the property. Here's the road, and there's a church. And then behind the church on 8 acres was the pastor's house. And then over here was another house. That's the house we lived in. And the school building was beside that. And he gets in his car to leave, and there are tears in the pastor's eyes and in the pastor's wife's. And he says to us, I don't know how much we're leaving. You know, we're leaving, you know, we're headed out of town, and we don't know what we're going to do. I don't know how much more we can take of this. Just come out of a meeting with the deacons, and there was trouble in the church about, I don't know, really nothing for the most part. But and they drove away. And I remember saying to Mary and thinking together, and we've talked about this many times over the years and said it many times again, that, well, no matter what happens, we get to be together. No matter what happens, we get to leave together. No matter what happens, we get to minister somewhere together. And God was helping to develop oneness in marriage through hurt, through things that were not certainly what we had planned. 2 months later, the pastor resigned, and after the deacons had come to him, said 90% of the church is against you, which wasn't true, but regardless, the pastor resigned, and they ended up leaving. And needless to say, you know, God was building us. He was strengthening us at that point. And to that point in our lives, that was one of the most difficult things we had ever dealt with, certainly in our early marriage. We had just had a new baby. Caitlin had just been born. We had just got our baby room just right. And we just had got new carpet in the parsonage that they had promised when we moved. But now we had a baby. They said, we promised them this. We better put new carpet. That baby's going to be crawling on that filthy carpet. And so they put new carpet and tile. And we had the house all painted and everything just the way we wanted it. The baby room done. Mary had done a harlequin pattern. It was pretty and all this on the wall. And lots of pink. And it was wonderful. And ministry, people would reach. We had started a bus route there in that church that they'd never had, and that was exciting. We had having 25 come on our bus, and we were excited about that. And relationships, all the relationships we had ever had as a married couple, friendships were in that church. And God was teaching us to just live with an open hand, just willing to let go of things, you know. And God led us from there and through that, because of the situation, we ended up resigning and God led us wonderfully to another place to minister in Indiana, and time goes on from there. But God was teaching us. He was building our marriage a oneness that regardless of what happens, we're together. We can survive our home and marriages, and God was building it. And I want you to know that's what God wants to do in your life. See, there are plenty of, and there have been plenty of other challenges since then. But that was the beginnings of God building. I've got, and been plenty of blessings since then too, let me say. God wants to do the same thing in your marriage. That's all just the introduction to the message. I'm going to give you the 3 points tonight about two becoming one. Oneness is essential for the home. Three things about oneness and why they're essential. I'll be back at 6 o'clock. I'll encourage you to be back at that time. I'm going to give you those 3 things, and that'll be the message tonight. Let's bow in prayer.